This video is the second in a short series on the mathematics of waves. In the first video, we derived an equation for the wave function for a sinusoidal wave moving on a string, and I'll post a link to that derivation real quick. The wave function turned out to be y of x and t is a cosine of the quantity kx minus omega t for a wave moving to the right. In this video, we start taking partial derivatives of this wave function. We interpret the physical meaning of those partial derivatives, and we arrive at the one-dimensional wave equation, which is a second-order partial differential equation governing the motion of waves on a string. So what we're looking at in the animation is a single point highlighted at a fixed value of x on a string with a sinusoidal wave passing through it. Recall that this point moves in simple harmonic motion, and the amplitude and frequency of this motion are the same for any point we might highlight along the string. The green vector shown attached to the point shows the y velocity at any moment, while the white vector shows the acceleration of the point at any moment. And our first goal here is to find expressions for the y velocity and y acceleration of this point. So we're going to freeze our animation at just some arbitrary time. And we start with our wave function y of x and t is a cosine kx minus omega t. And we want the rate of change in y with respect to time while holding x constant. This is the time derivative of y of xt, with x considered a constant, and that's called a partial derivative. The partial derivative gets a special notation with a stylized d that can sometimes be pronounced as del. So we'll say that our y velocity is del y del t, and we have to take that t derivative of the cosine function. Well, the derivative of the cosine gives us a negative sign, but then the chain rule tacks on a factor of negative omega, and the minus signs cancel. So we end up with a omega sine kx minus omega t for our velocity function. Now, sometimes we might be interested in writing down the maximum speed for a point on this string, and that will just be given by the coefficient of the sine function here. So we can say that v max is a omega. Next, we're going to take a second derivative of y with respect to time, the rate of change in the velocity, and that's the y acceleration. So we write del squared y over del t squared, taking another partial derivative with respect to time. And when we differentiate the sine function, we get the cosine function, but the chain rule produces a factor of negative omega again. So this time we end up with negative a omega squared cosine kx minus omega t. So there's our acceleration function, and we can find the maximum magnitude of that as well. Again, it's just the coefficient of that sinusoidal function, a omega squared. But here's the really important discovery in all of this. We just figured out that the second time derivative of our wave function is proportional to the original wave function. If we look at this expression, negative a omega squared cosine kx minus omega t, that's basically our original wave function. There's just a factor of negative omega squared out in front. So we can write that the second time derivative of our wave function is negative omega squared times the original wave function. And this property is true in general for sinusoidal functions. When you differentiate them twice, you end up with a minus sign, maybe some constants, and then the original function. In that discovery, that's really the most important thing on this slide, so it gets a box. Next, we start to investigate x derivatives of the wave function. So we've frozen the wave at a single moment in time, so we're holding time constant now, and we want to differentiate with respect to x. So we start with our wave function, and we take the first partial derivative with respect to x, treating t as a constant. So that's del y del x. Now the derivative with respect to x here, that's going to produce the negative of the sine function, and then the chain rule produces a factor of k. So this time we end up with a negative ka sine kx minus omega t. And the interpretation of that is that it's actually the slope of the string at that particular location at this particular time. And we continue by taking a second derivative, del squared y del x squared, and the interpretation of that is the curvature or the concavity of the string. So when that's positive, we're talking about upward curvature. When it's negative, we're talking about downward curvature. When we take this derivative, we end up with the derivative of the sine function, which is the cosine function, and another factor of k because of the chain rule. So our second derivative with respect to position is negative k squared a cosine kx minus omega t. And again, the most important thing here is to realize that that's proportional to the original wave function, a cosine kx minus omega t. So we end up with our second position derivative being equal to negative k squared times the original function. And again, that's the most important thing on this slide, so it gets a box. Now we have two equations relating second partial derivatives to the original wave function. So we can solve each of these for the original wave function and set them equal. For example, in the first one, the original wave function y is going to be negative 1 over omega squared times the second partial of y with respect to time. And we do a similar thing with the second equation. When we set these equal, we end up with this second order partial differential equation, negative 1 over k squared second partial with respect to x is equal to negative 1 over omega squared second partial with respect to t. And we're going to isolate that second partial derivative with respect to x. And that's really just a matter of tradition. And we arrive at this equation. So we have the second partial with respect to x is k squared over omega squared second partial with respect to t. Now we have to remember, and this was in our first wave mathematics video in this series, that the wave velocity is omega over k. Well, I see the reciprocal of that here, and it's squared. So the coefficient on the right-hand side is a 1 over v squared. And this is the one-dimensional wave equation describing the motion of waves on a string. Now, the solutions to this equation include both rightward and leftward moving waves. Now, the final point that I want to make here is that the wave equation tells us that when the curvature is upward, the acceleration of the point on the string is upward and vice versa. So remember the left side of the equation here, that's the curvature or concavity. If that's positive, we're talking about upward curvature. And that would imply that our second time derivative was positive. That's the acceleration. So I want to investigate on a more fundamental level, why should this be true? Why should upward curvature give positive accelerations and vice versa? So let's zoom in a little on our point. And now we can see that this point is in a region of upward concavity or upward curvature. And that means on the right side of that point, we have a little bit steeper slope than we do on the left side of the point. But the tension pulling in the string is basically the same on the right and left of that point. This means that force vector, that tension vector pulling up and to the right, has a slightly bigger y component than the tension vector that's pulling down and to the left. Again, it's the increased steepness of the slope as we go further to the right that causes the upward y component of force on this chunk of the string to outweigh the downward y component of the force. This results in a net y force pointing upward, and that's why we get an acceleration in the upward direction. Now, this sort of force reasoning is precisely what we need to arrive at the wave equation from a more fundamental perspective by using Newton's second law. That's the subject of the next video in the series, which you can link to at the top left, and I'll see you there.